Once again, I'm Pastor David Graham at Grace Community Church in Boulder City, Nevada, and this is our online service for the third Sunday in January. Let's begin by prayer. We're glad you joined us. Heavenly Father, I thank and praise you for everybody that's watching today. We ask your blessing to rest upon them, Lord. We pray for your wisdom and anointing. Give them favor wherever they go. Help them know that they are beloved beyond measure and that your loving kindness lasts forever. Father, we thank you for your taking care of us as you have so many ways. We love you now and we want to listen to the music and have the prayer together and hear the word of the Lord expounded. Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. An announcement. Our primary announcement is our annual meeting coming up on January 23rd. Everyone who is a member of the church needs to make every effort to be there at 1 o'clock on Sunday in the dining room. This year there will be no Zoom. If you are uncomfortable about coming, we understand. We need to have at least a quorum to do the business of the church, approve the 2022 budget, approve the salary package for all staff, approve bylaw changes, and so I'm announcing that online, and hopefully you'll be able to be with us on the 23rd. We will be requiring masks throughout the duration of the meeting. Thank you.
Please join me in Guide My Feet. Yes, my Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. Yes, my Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain.
Hallelujah. join me in singing Jesus, Shepherd of Our Thoughts. Jesus, Shepherd of our thoughts, gather all our thoughts in you, into your presence, bring us home. Jesus, Shepherd of our hearts, gather all our hearts in you, into your presence, bring us life. Jesus, Shepherd of our will, gather all our will in you, into your presence, bring us peace. Jesus, Shepherd of our thoughts, gather all our thoughts in you, into your presence, bring us home.
We do have, as I'm sitting here, a number of prayer requests, and all of them this time seem to be rather serious. Carl Murphy Framke, we have been praying for. He had some fluid taken out of his lungs, but in the meantime, there was a hole punched and his lungs got air. They're in the process right now of taking 2 or 3 days to remove the air. He's weak because of his precondition of his heart issues. There is a mass on his lungs and lower abdomen that they would like to take a biopsy, but they can't under the present condition. So he's in the hospital. We'll be there for some time. Also, Rich Loudon was taken to the hospital yesterday. He was confused all of a sudden. Don't know whether he had a TIA, a small stroke, but he doesn't know what year it is, where his address is, and he seems to be a little bit befuddled. Also today, Bob Wattenbarger was taken to the hospital. They can't find a room for him. He's in the hallway, emergency room. He also was very confused, his mind not working. And Judy got very worried. So both Barbara Murphy Framke and Judy Wattenbarger need our prayers too, to be strong and have a sense of peace that God is in control. We want to pray for all these precious ones. I also want to add Barbara Reed to that because she came down with COVID. I want to remember Janet Self, who is also recovering from COVID. And I want to remember Sandy Fiddler, who is sick, and we don't know if she has COVID. She hasn't been tested, but she's not feeling well at all today. Even though she is going to another church, she's still part of our fellowship. She comes to our Bible study every week on Thursday. So Sandy's son, Mike, has serious COVID, and Abby, his daughter, Sandy's granddaughter, has COVID, and they're not doing well. They're also struggling with it. So we need a lot of care. We need prayer for so many others that we haven't even mentioned, but would you join me in prayer for those? Father, we ask you to intervene. We ask, Lord, that you would close the gap between our ability to intercede on behalf of our loved ones, Lord, our church family and others that we know and love, Lord, and your healing power, Lord. We pray, Father, that we would all be in agreement because your promise was, in Matthew 18, if any two of us agree asking anything in your name, you would do it. So in the name of Jesus, we release the healing power of God into the lives of these who are laying and passively waiting for your touch from above. Thank you, Father. We love you and praise you and thank you for your faithfulness. Now we pray the prayer that you taught your first disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever. Amen.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, and with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, and with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary.
Now I'd like to share a word of scripture with you. Our first Old Testament reading is in Proverbs chapter 16, verses 21 through 24. Listen to the word of the Lord. The wise are known for their understanding, and pleasant words are persuasive. Discretion is a life-giving fountain to those who possess it, but discipline is wasted on fools. From a wise mind comes wise speech. The words of the wise are persuasive. Kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. That's wonderful thoughts from the Spirit of God in the book of Proverbs. And now, our New Testament reading is found in Galatians chapter 3. We're going to read from verse 23 down through verse 29. Hear the word of the Lord. Before the way of faith in Christ was available to us, we were placed under guard by the law. We were kept in protective custody, so to speak, until the way of faith was revealed. Let me put it another way, Paul says. The law was our guardian until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made right with God through faith. And now that the way of faith has come, we no longer need the law as our guardian. But you are all sons of daughters of God through your faith in Christ. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ, like putting on new clothes. There is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female, but you are all one in Christ Jesus. And now that you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. You are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you. Well, those are amazing words, and I would love to try to expound them and go on and on, but we are now ready to go into our message.
Sentire come nel mio cuore, oh mio.
Today, I want to talk to you about the third core value that we have adopted as Grace Community Church. These core values share our distinctives. There are six of them. The first one had to do with the inspiration of Scripture. The second one has to do with Christ-likeness, the idea that we have been reborn to be shaped into the very image of Jesus Christ. And this third one has to do with loving relationships, but it's also about our unique big tent philosophy. You don't have to agree with everything that I preach. You do need to hear the word of the Lord graciously, wrestle with it, and let the Holy Spirit help you rightly divide it. No two of us has seen through the words of the Bible and come out with the same conclusions. We have different educational backgrounds, different cultural preferences. We have family backgrounds. We have different religious experiences. And yet what we have in common is our belief in Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world, the Son of God, and that we have embraced by faith his work of redemption on the cross. So let me begin this lesson today by reading this particular core value. The first phrase is, we value unity in diversity. Therefore, we will respect differing understandings of biblical texts and social and political views. We will strive to love each other as God loves us, and for unity in acceptance and forgiveness. We will seek for humility and a listening spirit when in dialogue with others. So those are the key ideas of our core value number three. Notice the key points in this. Number one, unity in diversity. This means that we are all different in all kinds of ways, but we willingly choose to walk together as one family of God. Second, respect. We're going to respect differing interpretations of Scripture, differing views on social issues, and tolerance for people of a different political persuasion than yours. Now, this has been a challenge when Donald Trump was the president, for example, and I don't want to get into any of that, but we did have people leave the church because they felt that they didn't want to fellowship with other believers who didn't view the political spectrum in the same way. And that's a shame, and that's nonsense. Number three, we choose to love one another unconditionally, respecting each other and accepting each other in spite of differences. Number four, we will be quick to forgive when we feel wronged. Number five, we will develop the fruit of the Spirit of humility. Five, we will learn the skill of being an active listener when speaking with each other. Now for the text of this morning's message. In Philippians 2, 1 through 4, we read, listen carefully. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Thinking of others is better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Well, that's the passage. So here's a question for you. Why is it typical for you and I to be uncomfortable around people that do not look like us, do not think like us, do not dress like us, or that we don't know very well. My guess is that we're tribal people. Our ancestors came from unusually monolithic cultures to America, which was a melting pot. We generally, psychologically, as a rule, feel more comfortable around people with whom we can easily identify similarities, race, class, religion, to mention just three. As humans, we like familiarity, and we tend to be distrustful of people and or situations that we don't fully understand. It's most likely just our core human nature. Like begets like. We must learn how to accept others who are different from us. This means that we consciously choose to accept others, even when they differ from us. Allow me to explain. When I was in Santa Barbara as senior pastor of Bethany Congregational Church, it was an historical Japanese church and offered worship services each week, both in Japanese and in English. Many of our people had lived through the deprivations of the World War II incarceration camps scattered throughout the West. And almost all of those people could remember their childhoods in these camps. They shared a common bond through their common experience. Many had been uprooted from their homes and farms and businesses, never to recoup the losses incurred by 5 years of total separation. But there were no, in that church, Bethany Congregational, no outward signs or markings on the church which would identify it as a Japanese cultural heritage church made up mostly of Asians in the congregation. And so when Caucasian visitors would occasionally try us out, they seldom returned. They did not know that we were majority Asian, even though we had a Caucasian pastor. On at least two occasions, those folks told me in follow-up calls that they were just not comfortable worshiping among people who were different from themselves. And I suppose at some level I can understand and even appreciate that. But in another way, as fellow believers in Jesus Christ, it would and could have been a wonderful learning and growing time for them if they had just stuck it out among people who are somewhat different than they are. They would have come to appreciate the finer elements of an ancient Japanese culture whose respect for others and common suffering had molded them into a very sensitive and caring and deep people. I did not understand their reticence then, and I still don't. I guess because I grew up in Los Angeles and attended grade school with many different racial groupings. Color was just not an issue in my early years. In fact, for me, I kind of like the diversity of differing ethnicities and colors bring to our world. A multi-ethnic quilt, which is far more interesting than just one boring and bland racial cultural sameness. Catch my meaning? Perhaps you too remember the little song we used to sing in Sunday school. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Brown and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Do you remember that song? It is truly a blessing to be able and be willing to celebrate the differences in the human race. The Bible clearly teaches that we were all created, all of us created in the image of God. Here's the text in Genesis chapter 1. Then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. So we begin there with this understanding that all humans, no matter what their color, shape of their eyes, position of their nose, short, tall, are created in the image of God. And because this is so, all of our dealings with other human beings should begin from that base point. It is the universal imago Dei which makes us truly one race of beings, and therefore to be honored, loved, and cherished. Now listen, dear church, dear Grace Community Church, and others who may be watching this online, we need to grow in this area. You know, this weekend, Monday, is Martin Luther King Jr. Day, the first national holiday in honor of an African-American descended person. Many of you know the story of Martin Luther King Jr., how he was jailed many times, how he fought for racial justice when, especially in some southern states, there were all kinds of little tricks to disenfranchise black people. I even read one time during the time, because in 1963, I was just a freshman in high school, or a sophomore, I think, by then. And I remember, you know, being aware of some of the hosings and seeing on television dogs yapping at black people. And even then, I felt something is wrong with this picture. What's going on down there? Of course, these people were different from us. But racial discrimination, which should have been ended over 100 years after Lincoln, on January in 1863, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And around the country, black congregations gathered in their respective places, waiting for a wire to say that it happened, because some of them weren't sure it could happen. It was too good to be true, that all of a sudden, with a stroke of a pen, they would all be now free. And that began the time when America was made clean. And I have much, much more I want to talk about that. Maybe I will in our live service. But God so loved the world, it says in John 3:16, that he gave us our Savior. Aren't we also to so love the world? We are called in Scripture to love God with all of our hearts and our neighbor as ourselves. We're called to be people of love, people like us and people different from us. We need to remove personal bias from our minds, respecting the differences as God's grand creative artist palette. Awaken sympathy and empathy for each other. And with the help and infusion of the Holy Spirit, we can do this. Because when God's love, unconditional love, is placed in our hearts, we need to express that unconditional love to people that are quite a bit different from us, and even people that don't like us. Wasn't it Jesus who said we are to love our enemies, to love people who oppose us, to love people who slander us? Aren't we supposed to represent the sacrificial unconditional of our Savior, Jesus Christ? Listen, above all, don't judge other people based on your very fleeting idea that comes across your mind. It is God's place and God's place alone to judge anyone. Who are we to cast stones against our brother or judge our brother or sister? Or for that matter, anyone else that you come across? Hear the word of the Lord in Matthew 7, 1 and 2. Do not judge others and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. Uh-oh, I better be very careful. What I think in my mind or what I speak with my mouth about so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so. But there's more. Not only should we respect others because of the common imago Dei, the image of God in each and every human being, we are also called to go beyond that respect and to love one another. Jesus gave us a new commandment, to love one another. In John 13:34, he says, so now I am giving you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. I love you this morning, this afternoon, this evening, whenever you're watching this. Do you love me? Do you love the person who lives next door? Do you love the people that live downstairs from you? Do you love the people that are in the parking lot at the grocery store? Do you love the people that you see in the storm? God says we're to love. Love is at the core of all of our Christian relationships with each other and with the larger world. It is the agape quality of love from God that fills our hearts through the life of the Spirit who indwells each of us who have received the grace and forgiveness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And because we love each other, we don't judge. And we are quick to forgive when somebody trespasses against us. And we try to make every effort to understand each other. And we try to listen carefully. What is this person trying to say? What's at the core? What's the source of their frustration or their animosity? And when we disagree with each other, we decide to disagree agreeably. Amen. Look, I don't agree with your position on that. But, you know, this is a free country, and you have the right to believe and think about as you will about those things. I just see it differently. But I still love you, and it doesn't change my feelings for you. In other words, as John Wesley once said about the Methodists when he was being criticized, we think and let think. And that sums up what I'm trying to say. You have the right to think about things as you think, but you also need to let others think about the things that they think. We think and let think, but we never divide over theological disagreements, political differences, or even differing opinions on hot button social issues like abortion or gay marriage. And we could go on. And politically, it's the same. For example, we already mentioned when President Trump was president, and now President Biden is president. All we are told as believers is to pray for whoever is in authority. We prayed for Trump when he was in president. We pray for Biden when he's president. And whoever is the next president, we pray for them also. And we might despise everything about someone's personal style or whatever, but these differences in opinion or preference are not to divide the body of Christ. But I've seen it happen right here at Grace. I'm not going to name names, but there are some people who no longer attend here because they heard other people talking about a political situation and they had a different opinion. They said, well, I can't fellowship with that. Nothing can be more ridiculous than that. That's wrong, simply wrong, because we are one. We share the same blood. When we take communion, the blood of Christ, we are receiving the same forgiveness. And by participating in Jesus Christ, we are made one in spirit. Our unity is not to be discovered in our sameness, but in our common adoption as sons and daughters of our Father in heaven. All of us should be humbled by our shared recipients of the grace and forgiveness of our Father. Therefore, in the church, we are all blood brothers and sisters. We cannot and should not and cannot dismember the body of Christ. We do so whenever we separate from each other or even allow negative feelings about someone or listen to gossip which is negative or depressing. And when we judge each other and put each other down, and whenever we do not fully embrace one another out of brotherly love and concern. Amen? We're called to respect each other because we can see Jesus in each other. Look for him in your brother or sister. We listen to each other, trying to understand, asking questions for clarity out of sincerity, not just thinking, oh, that person doesn't have a clue. And when we have differing ideas and opinions, we share them ever so gently, never getting in heated arguments, but respecting each other because we are one in Christ. Now, I know that's easier said than done, but I'm trying to hold up the standard here and not wallow in the mud down here. In closing, I want to share with you the warm oil which will lubricate the many active and moving parts of an active and growing church. It is the oil of appreciation. That's one wonderful way you can share your love and concern for others. There are several people that seem to have that gift, and I've observed them from time to time, not only sharing that gift with me and encouraging me, but I've watched them share it with other people and saying the most wonderful, gracious things that just lift that individual up. And hopefully they don't ever forget that somebody really sees them, honors them, and values them as a fellow member of the many functioning body of Christ. You see, we don't vocally and visibly appreciate each other enough. Personally, I'm very proud of most of all of you. So many times I've observed your dedication and loving service here at Grace Community Church. But I tell you about that? Not enough. In fact, if I could sit down here and make a whole list, it'd probably take me the next 15 minutes just to write everybody's name down that I can think of. So let me say it right here, right now, for those of you who at least are watching, and I'll tell those who come in person too. I loved you, all of you, so very much. And I'm so grateful that the Lord has placed me here. Among you, you've blessed me in so many ways. And I appreciate so much how so many of you sacrifice your time and have committed yourself to the activities of this church, your offerings, your lives, your willingness to serve on commissions and so forth to make Grace Community Church the very unique and wonderful place that it actually is. And I'm proud that my membership is here. I hope you are. And I'm thankful how the Holy Spirit has brought us together in unique ways we can never fully understand until we're on the other side. And that the Lord is gracious and kind. And we all should be very gratefully humble. I'm glad you're in my life. And I hope you're glad that I'm in your life. May you be blessed, highly favored, in Jesus' name. Amen.
you.